Hi, good evening. I'm Karan, and we also have Yogita here from Green Essentials. And welcome to this session. Thanks for making the time to be here. I want to thank Hasgeek for helping us put this together. I think it would have been another decade before we tried it if it wasn't for them. And we hope that what we talk about here and what we try to explain here is useful to you. This session is titled Anyone Can Grow. And what we're going to do is we're going to start with a presentation for about 15, 20 minutes where we're going to talk about several things. And then we'll move on to question and answers that you may have wanting to clarify different things, right? So as I said, thank you for making the time to join us. We hope that this will be both informative and useful for you. All of us are stuck home and wondering to some extent what to do with our time. Also, perhaps to another extent, what kind of difficulties we are going to face over the next few weeks or maybe even months. I think there are certain implications that COVID-19 has for people who are very newly interested in gardening. One of the things that I think we need to ask ourselves is that are we going to face food uncertainty in a very personal way? And the question is, will we face this for the next 7 days, the next 3 weeks, or for 3 months? We also need to ask ourselves whether we should wait to act or whether we should try and do something quickly in order to mitigate the impact of any disruption to fresh fruits and vegetables. So these are the most important because these are the most likely to be disrupted. Non-perishable goods don't tend to have problems to the same extent, at least based on what we've seen in this past 2 weeks. And fresh food is something that, at least in India, most of us can't stay without. You know, we can't do without our vegetables. If you take this example of a typical Indian family, most of the food that is consumed is fresh. And this contrasts greatly with families in the West. For example, this American family, most of the food that they consume is processed food. It's non-perishable food, right? So very different challenges between us and them. Homegrown food is not an impossibility. For most people who have been doing this for a while, they will find that it's pretty easy to grow food. And once you get the hang of it, it can be pretty productive. And this is possible for small spaces, not just from big spaces. Now, the question is, why act now? We are around, I think, 2 weeks in with one more week to go, hopefully. But signs are that this is going to get extended in the next couple of months. The first thing that we see is that we have a choice. Either we respond very proactively to the situation and do some things ourselves, or we choose to wait for someone else to come and rescue us, to provide solutions for our food. The second thing of concern is the fact that the real food shortages may come afterwards. We may not have faced them yet. These are going to happen because food production has been paused, farms haven't been tended to, and so on. And the impact of this may be a month from now or 2 months from now, right? So what we are suggesting is that we should be growing in containers, in sunny balconies, in terraces, and so on, because these can be pretty productive. They can produce at least some amounts of the food that we enjoy eating. One of the things that Yogita has always said right from the time we started growing about 13 years ago is that anyone can grow. A common misconception is that it takes a very special kind of personality or people are born with this skill. It's not true. This is something that can be acquired provided you are persistent enough and interested in doing this. So small growing places, as I said earlier, can be very productive. We believe the other benefit is that your health, is a priority. You have very good organic food that you can grow at home, and therefore it becomes a priority. And another benefit that you will have in addition to this will be that it allows you to have much fresher food, much more nutritious and flavorful food than you have been used to, perhaps when you're buying vegetables from the market. But the key issue, obviously, that we are talking about right now is to avoid any great disruption to the access that we have to vegetables in the near term. So given the lockdown, there are certain constraints that we face. We can't go out shopping and or, you know, use Amazon to order the perfect inputs in. We cannot get soil, perhaps potting soil to grow. Seeds may be difficult to access. Even things like manure and so on is very difficult to get at this point in time. And we have no clarity on when these will be available. So we believe that you can move ahead despite these constraints. But we often find that a lot of people just feel uncertain because they don't have the knowledge. So people will say that I don't have a green thumb. Somebody will say that I can't possibly grow everything I need to eat. So what's the point? Or that I've got very little space to grow. So does it even make sense? Or, perhaps, you know, I can't find the time either because work from home is turning out to be much more complicated than we thought, or because you'd rather read a book or something like that. So we are suggesting that, let's set aside these excuses because there is a real danger of food security for us down the line. Yeah. So let's not get things all scrambled. What we suggest very strongly is that we start with the very simple task. And that simple task that we are trying to achieve is that we are trying to make sure that we take the first step that we can take right now. Yeah. So there are different growing stages. Typically, we start with seeds and nurseries. Then we move on to soil preparation, transplanting or sowing, and growing and caring. Harvesting is, of course, the stage that we are waiting for. And we then get to plan the next cycle. Yeah. So these are the typical stages in a garden. And we are going to take you through these stages one by one over the next few weeks. Now, to begin with, you have to decide what do you have available around the house. Yeah. So most of our households have very few seedlings that we can kind of seeds available with us. So what we're going to try and figure out is how can you, without leaving your house or not going without going very far from your house, actually address most of these issues. Yeah. Sorry, give us a moment. We're having a problem with the microphone. Yogita, can you hear?
I can hear.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. So the question is, what do you have around the house? I'll pass on to Yogita so she can talk about that.
Okay. So actually, when we were experiencing this lockdown, I got a lot of questions, people saying that, you know, how do I get seeds? Where do we grow? We are stuck at home. We can't even access that. So not only me, but a lot of people have realized that there's a lot of stuff actually in your kitchen cupboard itself that if you just rummage through or even look through your racks, you'll find stuff that you can grow. I've made a little collection of things that would be easy for people to pick out from their homes. The easiest, and almost every house has rye or mustard. These germinate very quickly. They grow into greens and they can add a nice leafy green, you know, to your plate in a short amount of time. Similarly with methi, methi seeds, again, easily available with most people at their homes. Even coriander seeds. Coriander seeds are also another popular thing. Remember, coriander seeds are... they're compound seeds. You have to crush them so that they split into two and then you sow them. You can soak them in water for a little while and that's how they grow. You can also use things like chilies. Remember, the red chilies and not the green ones, because in the red chilies, whether they are dried like this or red fresh like this, you slit them, you remove the seed and you use. The green ones are not mature. So if you use seeds from the green chili, they will not work. You can plant something like a tomato. All you need to do is cut a slice of it. Take another slice that has seeds in it. You know, place it in your pot or in wherever you're going to raise the nursery. Put the soil, start watering, and each of those seeds will germinate into plants. Another exciting thing I found is just planting onions. Onions can be expensive, but if you like onions and you have some extra lying around, you basically put them in. And they grow the greens, and the greens are useful. You won't get more onions, but you will get the greens that can be snipped and they'll come back again. Another thing that is nice to have around the house is pudina. It's bought from the market. But if you strip the bottom leaves and just leave a few leaves on the top and you plant a bunch of these, just put them in a cup of water, they will sprout roots and then they can be transplanted in the pot you want to grow in. Or you could even just directly strip the leaves, put it in the pot and it will grow from there. Another recent example I tried, my aunt bought me some popcorn to make for my daughter. And I thought that, you know, as it was getting over, I said, perhaps I can just put some seeds in and see what happened. And it took about 3 months. The plants grew. I harvested popcorn and I dried it thoroughly. And I got more popcorn. I harvested about maybe 750 grams from a few plants. So that's almost a kilo of popcorn. Some I will eat and some I will put back into the soil. There are actually, you know, if you just stop and look around, you'll find a number of other things. You can use potatoes that have grown eyes. You can put those in. You can put a lot of the lentils, but they have a much longer cycle. You can try pumpkin. You know, most pumpkins come with seeds inside. You dry those, you can grow more pumpkin plants. You need to have a lot of space though to grow that. Papaya, similarly, a good tasting papaya, dry the seed and use them. So all in all, there's a lot you can find in your kitchen. Once you have all this together, it's important to remember that what Karan had mentioned, there are stages. And right now we'll focus just on setting up your nursery. You gather your seeds, you gather containers. And the first step is basically we get started with the nursery. Once I have a bunch of these seeds, I'm going to go over to what containers can we use to grow the stuff in. So most homes will have some, you know, take out containers of different sizes. You'll have perhaps an unused tiffin box or something that is not required anymore. These days, whatever, you know, curds and things you buy, you get containers of different sizes. So all these can be used. If you recently had a party at home, you may have paper cups that are lying around. So all these can be used to raise nurseries. That is the first step. And then once these plants are about 3 weeks or so old, you will transplant them into pots, which we will get to later and we'll talk about later. But the first step is to grow the nurseries. Now, remember one important thing. These containers, they must have holes at the bottom so that the water drains out. With a paper cup, it's easy. You just take a ballpoint pen and prick it and you're ready to go. But with these, you need to just heat up a screwdriver, poke about 3 to 4 holes so that the water drains. Very important. Another thing, sometimes people do have old seeds lying in the house and they don't know what to do. You can actually do a germination test in a paper towel. Just put 10 seeds in it, moisten the towel, roll it up, stick it into a plastic bag and wait for about a week or so. And just check every 2-3 days to see how many of those have germinated. It'll give you a sense of whether the seeds are viable or not. Now, I'll just quickly, as an example, show you what I would do with this chili over here. The idea is that when you're sowing, you break open this chili, there's a bunch of seeds inside. And obviously, I don't need so many. I am going to put like maybe 5 to 8 seeds, just literally sprinkle it on top. And I have gone down and gotten some soil from my compound. One of the big problems a lot of you might face who don't have soil at home is, what do we do for soil? So that's a hard one, but just, you know, go down to your building, or maybe you have an old pot that has some ornamentals growing in it. It's a good time to get rid of the ornamentals. You use that soil, let that be your starting point. And there are ways that you can actually build good soil over time. And we'll talk about that later. And once you've put in your seeds, literally with a handful more of soil, just cover it up so that it's not visible and water it, sprinkle it with light, a light sprinkling of water, and you're ready to go. So that's basically how you would plant a bunch of seeds, different things to get started. Over to Karan.
As Yogita has just said, you know, these are the case stages of actually putting together your kitchen garden. And these nurseries become critical in the process because they allow you to get a head start. We are still a few days away from where we may be able to access pots, soil and other things. But in the meantime, our nurseries can progress ahead up to the point we are ready to transplant, right? So ideally, as Yogita said, we use these containers to grow the seedlings over the next 21 to 25 days. And then we move on to having seedlings that we can actually transplant. Now, please remember that if you look, each of these pots has a lot of seedlings. But eventually, we will plant only one of these seedlings in each growing pot, which is usually of a larger size. Quite often, for most vegetables, we tend to have 8 or 10 inch pots, you know, which we use to grow. You would have noticed that there are a bunch of pots Yogita has sitting behind her on a counter. And, you know, we have spinach there, we have kale there, we have some mustard greens, and we have amaranth. And all of these things are, except for the amaranth, are basically one pot growing, one plant growing in the pot. Yeah. So what comes next? Now that you have got your seeds underway, assuming you've gone, found seeds, and you have planted them in these little cups, what you have to do next is wait. You have to tend to these plants carefully. You have to make sure that they get sufficient light, and wait for the point where they have about 4 to 5 leaves and are ready for transplant, right? So taking care of your nursery will occupy the next 2 or 3 weeks. Transplanting your seedlings will happen after that, and we shall talk about it in a subsequent session. You will need to work to get your soil right and make sure that it is ready for those young plants and can provide nutrition for them even as they grow. And lastly, of course, you will be caring for the plants as they grow up to the point when they get to harvest, right? As you can see, these plants can get very productive. This is a bunch of pots that we have, you know, at our place, which are providing us a lot of food at this point in time. We have some Chinese cabbage. We have some spinach in there and many other plants growing too. Now, when we move ahead with this, I'd just like you to keep in mind a few mistakes that we've seen a lot of new gardeners tend to make. This is especially so in the nurseries, right? So people tend to sow their seeds too deep. So what they will do is that they will put a whole fistful of seeds and dump it into the cup, and everything will crowd together and, you know, sort of stifle the, each other and so on, right? So you want to avoid doing this. Quite often, if you have a small cup, maybe just put 2 or 3 seedlings at the very most in it, right? If it's one of those paper cups Yogita was talking about, then just one seed in each cup will do also. The next thing is that you can't just keep the plants in the shade and expect them to grow. Most plants require sunlight in order to kick off their photosynthesis process. And it's important that they therefore, get decent amounts of sunlight, say 3 to 4 hours in the day at least, right? So if they get good light without too much heat, that is an almost ideal situation for most seedlings. Overwatering of plants is another thing a lot of beginners tend to do. So you have to be very careful that you avoid doing this. If they are very young plants, they can get battered down if your flow of water is too hard. And, the roots tend to rot if there's too much water too. You can easily just touch your finger or push your finger a little below the level of the soil to check if there's moisture. If there's moisture, don't water again. And if it's dried out, then you can water. Yeah. You should have appropriate containers, not too big and not too small. In order to make sure that the plants have room to grow and have enough nutrients inside them. And lastly, you shouldn't grow too much of one thing. This is a very common mistake that all of us make when we start growing, that we will get all excited, have one thing work, and then we've got only that one thing happening. It's not too much fun to eat just the same thing every day. And more importantly, you tend to attract much more in terms of pests if you have a monoculture of sorts growing in your garden, right? So there are some garden hacks that I would say that you can incorporate in once the plants are on their way. I'm going to just ask Yogita to go ahead with and explain some of these.
So these are actually fertility hacks, if you can call them that. Karan, can I see the screen of the presentation? So basically, things like rice water. When we wash rice, all the water that we are draining off actually has quite a bit of nutrients and is useful for plants. Even anything that has been fermented, good or great soil actually has a lot of microbes in it. So we want to introduce microbes. So things like curds, whether they've gone sour or whatever, you know, just add a little water, dilute it and put it, distribute it amongst your pots. If you make dosa batter at home, that's an excellent, you know, fermented concoction. Once you scraped off everything, then you can just, you know, again, pour water and distribute it across your pots. You know, fish water, for those of you who are non-veg, that's amazing. It really makes your leaves shine and it really goes a long way as far as nutrients go. Milk water, if you've, you know, just finished milk from a vessel, again, just swirl the water around and pour it. So these are actually all resources that we don't realize, literally just we throw them down the drain. It can be used to improve soil fertility. Eggshells, tea leaves, coffee grounds, dried banana skin, very high in magnesium. Eggshells would add calcium to your soil. So all these actually that we tend to throw away can go back into your soil to enrich fertility. And of course, we can talk about this later at some point, is that you need to start composting your waste, your kitchen waste, because therein lies a lot of nutrition and a lot of food for your plants coming straight out of your kitchen. So, and then some, you know, pest management strategies that you can employ when you're at home. Some of us who smoke will have cigarettes lying around. Just break open a couple of cigarettes in some water. You spray that for, you know, to control different pests like aphids and things. Chili, ginger, garlic sprays. Sounds like the recipe, but I mean, I wouldn't like chili, ginger, garlic sprayed on me. So imagine a little bug. It sort of torments it and they leave and they go. Simple soap solutions. They are also pretty effective. And, you know, things like caterpillars, just watch, look at your plants and literally just pick and flick them. And that's a great way to get rid of some kinds of insects on your plants.
Okay. So now that we've got a sense of what we need to do in the immediate future, perhaps we could start, you know, as early as tomorrow. We will also look a little further down the line and try to understand some of the things that you should start planning for or doing. Yogita mentioned composting your kitchen waste. It just makes a lot of sense, especially in a time when compost or you know, cow dung or inputs like that are difficult to find. The second thing I'd strongly suggest you do is actually see if you can use this time to collect in a bag, perhaps dried leaves from your neighborhood, maybe your compound or your street, if you have the option to get out at least that far at some point in time. These can be very useful for the growing purpose, and we'll talk about it a little bit later. And you know, it's a much better thing to use without wasting rather than just burning leaves, which is what ends up happening a lot of the time, also creating pollution, of course. Right. So the reason that we're asking you to create these leaves is they can be used as mulch. You basically will set up your pots once the plants are ready to transplant, and you will want to protect the soil with mulch layer, which is about 2 to 3 inches of these leaves. So if you can look at the image over here, you will see the soil is not visible. It's completely protected from the sunlight. And you know, that keeps the soil better. It retains moisture for a longer period of time, and it also completely eliminates the need for weeding. So unless you like to work 3 or 4 times as hard as you really want to be working, it's just much simpler if you just do mulch in the garden, right? Now, a quick summary to the session today. The first thing that we are proposing is just get started now. Don't hold on and wait to see what happens, because you know, in a best case scenario, you will have more food, which is better tasting and more nutritious, along with what food you're able to get from the regular sources. The worst case scenario, it will hold you in good stead in case perishable vegetables become difficult to get in the days to come. What you need to do is be patient yourself. You need to allow your garden and your skills to evolve slowly as we proceed, right? This is something you're new at. You're not expected to be a genius at it immediately. Just hold on and be calm. Now use what's available. Be innovative and, or rather, be resourceful in terms of looking around to see which things you can easily use. Yogita has mentioned many things that we look at as waste, you know, which can act as nutrients for the plants and should be used in that way. So just try and accumulate these things, and if they are easy to access, go out and get them. If they are, you know, in your house, then even better. Persist with the growing. You may have struggles at the beginning, but we will try and address many of these questions or problems that you face in subsequent sessions, which we'll be doing in about a week from now. Next Thursday will be the next session, right? And remember, we all make mistakes. especially when we are gardening. And Yogita and I, between the two of us, have probably killed more plants than everybody else on this webinar ever. So we would have killed these plants, of course, over 13 years. But don't mind if you lose a few plants. It's not really the end of the world. So speaking of the session next week, what we want to have next week is a session on troubleshooting your nurseries. So you would have started these nurseries and they would have hopefully germinated. And you would then want to know how you can solve problems that may occur with them. So we'll help with that. And we'll also talk about getting your pots prepared and ready for transplanting. So you need to find the right containers, perhaps drill holes in them to make sure the drainage is proper, you know, fill them up with soil that you can find handy, right? And get them ready for growing. And yes, never forget, cover them with mulch. So as soon as you've put the soil in, you have to cover it with mulch, right? This session will be on Thursday, the 16th of April. So, you know, do join us if you've found this particular session has got you started. To register, there's a link there to the Hasgeek site, same page that you went to sign up for this session. Please go there and sign up for the session. Thank you so much. We've finished pretty much the main section. We'll have questions and answers after this. If you want to write into us, you can write to info@greenessentials.in. And you can also sign up for this software called Slack, which will allow us to hear your questions and answers. The URL is friends.hasgeek.com. So just go up there, sign up, and put up your questions, and we should be able to answer many of your questions too. Right? I think we'll just pause and take questions now. So if some of you have sent your questions in,
There is one question in the chat actually. Is how do you get rid of white insects on chili plants?
Okay, so usually it depends what the insect is, but usually the white insects could be white flies or they could be aphids. But check your humidity levels. If your soil is too wet, it'll attract these bugs. So make sure you're not overwatering. Make sure your plant is in a nice sunny spot. And if you do have a lot of them, just take a simple soap spray, and with your fingers, just get rid of them. Another way is to make a simple Mehra solution. It's sticky. You spray it. It sort of gets onto the wings of the white flies and it, and they fall off as the Mehra dries. So that's a simple way to tackle it.
We have one more question. It's my strawberry plants produced flowers, but never converted into fruits. You know why that happens?
Okay, so I'll answer that question. Now, what typically, the question is at what point they produce flowers, right? So you may have a situation in which your strawberry plants have produced flowers a little later because when the weather has turned hot, and that will have some impact on the amount of fruit that you will produce. One interesting thing to note about strawberry plants is if you feed them too well, then they produce a lot of leaf and not so much in terms of flowers itself, right? The second thing that could sort of reduce the amount of fruiting that you have with strawberry may be the soil nutrition at the later stages also. So what we do is we frequently add liquid nutrients. I guess in the lockdown, it would be nutrients like fish manure and so on, liquid fish manure that you could put in. We tend to use, when things are normal, we tend to use something called Panchagavya or Jeevamrit and tend to spray the plants with these.
Maybe little wood ash also.
So the next question is, what is the right time to harvest beetroot?
Okay, so good question. The first thing, what is the right time to grow beetroot? Now, beetroot is a winter crop. So if you don't have cool weather, you will have a lot of leaves, but you will not have a lot of root form, right? So typically beetroot will take about 2.5 to 3 months in order to form its root. And the best way to kind of figure it out is to poke your fingers right at the base of the leaves and feel how big the root is without actually pulling it out. So with radish, beetroot, and even carrots, that's what we tend to do in order to get a sense of size. That's when we would harvest the beet, when it's of a reasonable size.
Can I add something?
Sure.
Yeah, okay. So the other thing is a lot of the root vegetables, they tend to jump out of the soil or pop out of the soil. So as a regular thing when you are growing, just make sure you mound around the base of the plant. So whatever it is, whether it's an onion, whether it's a radish or it's a beetroot, it's not exposed. If it's exposed, it tends to get over mature very fast. It'll become fibrous and it won't be fun to eat. So just make sure you mound the soil around it and just the leaves are visible and not the root itself.
The next question is, my building has garden. Will that do? It's from Seaman Bawa.
Okay, so basically, I am assuming that there is a patch of soil that is available within the complex itself. Can you grow there? Certainly, you can grow there. You can grow in the ground. You can grow in pots. Personally, quite often we find, especially for people new to it, it's a little easier to do it in pots because the soil is sort of isolated from the rest of the garden. But at the same time, growing in a garden is equally productive. You can get very good results there. And, most of our growing has been in gardens since we have the luxury, a lot of space in Goa relative to what is available in a city, say like Bangalore.
I'll add one more thing, Simon. Just make sure that you have enough sunlight there. If it's under the shade of a tree and it's a densely shaded area, you'll have a hard time growing many of the vegetables. Sunlight is important. Like a minimum of 4 hours of sunlight is good to have.
Hi, we have a few more questions in chat. How to
treat leaf curl on chili and bell pepper plants?
Sorry, could you just repeat that, please?
How do you treat leaf curl on chili and bell pepper plants?
These are existing gardeners. These are not new gardeners. But okay, you want to take that? Yeah.
So leaf curl is actually a fungal problem. And, conditions that promote fungal problems are if there is continuous or too much dampness in the soil. So I think one of the problems a lot of gardeners face is unintentionally is that they do tend to overwater. Water when the soil looks dry, don't just water every day because it's something you think that needs to be done. Now, that's a preventive thing. Having said that, you've suppose done some of the preventive things, adding good microbes to the soil so that the soil builds its ability to, deal with the bad microbes that are there would help. So you could add regularly a little bit of sour curd. You can add milk when available. If you can buy panchagavya from the market, that usually helps. Also, maybe adding a little bit of baking soda to your soil will make your soil a little more alkaline, assuming your soil is not alkaline. If you're on the coast of India, your soil tends to be more acidic and that sort of is preferred by microbes. So if you add a little bit of baking soda, it makes the soil more neutral and reduces the incidence of fungal issues. But try to do more of the preventive stuff so you don't end up with the problem. Assuming you have leaf curl, just populate your soil with good microbes, given the restrictions, that should help.
So just adding to what Yogita said, prevention is really the key word. One of the things that we have to realize that is different between an organic system of growing, something we suggest because, that's what we've been doing for a long period of time and had good results with, is that in a curative system, like if you look at most chemical growing systems, they emphasize the cure to a great extent. That's what's really led to the proliferation of pesticides and so on, right? So in an organic system, you try and implement different kinds of very preventive measures. And these kind of ensure that your plants have an environment in which they can flourish. So that's really the goal when you're looking at it. You don't try to take too much curative action, really.
Okay, next question. What are the best vegetables to grow this season in Goa?
Okay,
so Yogi, you want to take that?
Okay, so obviously the coming months are going to be pretty warm. So the categories of vegetables usually are all the beans. You have the long beans, locally they're called iril, virvir. Basically, they're the yard-long beans. They're available in two colors over here. The seeds are around, the green one, the red one. You can grow French bean also will grow. You can grow cluster beans, chitki mitki, guar, So these are the beans. You can grow all kinds of gourds. You can grow bitter gourd. You can grow karela. Bitter gourd is karela. Sponge gourd, konkan dudi, the bottle gourd. You can grow cucumbers. You can grow sponge gourd, I said. What else?
Ridge gourd, I guess.
Ridge gourd, that's the other one you can grow. So the beans, the gourds, and then you can grow tomatoes. Actually, tomatoes, if you're in Goa, by the time you hit flowering and fruiting, the rains will come. So don't bother with tomatoes. But you can grow brinjals. You can grow chilies. You can grow corn. Corn can grow 12 months of the year in Goa. You can...
Ladyfinger, I guess we would ask.
Ladyfinger, that's an important one. And some of these will actually see you right through the rains. If you plant now and your brinjal gets productive by the time the rains come, you will have, you know, production right through the rain. So these are some of the things you can start out with right now.
Okay, next question. Last year in April, my berries and guava gave a lot of fruits, but for the past 6 months, it's not been fruiting. What may be the reason?
These are berries in?
Berries and guava is what Sneha Shah has mentioned. Nothing specific.
Okay.
Berries and guava. What kind of berries?
I'll just clarify that in some time.
Not a problem. We can maybe address another one in the meantime.
The next question, how do you understand what weather would support which crop?
Good question. So good question. Let's try and kind of understand the three seasons a little better, right? Some of this is stuff that we sort of know, but it's at the periphery, I think, of our knowledge, or rather our memory, and therefore we tend to get confused about it. The fact that you get all vegetables at all times of the year in the supermarket doesn't help, right? It makes it confusing. The first thing, what requires cold weather? So those are things that you would only grow in the winter. There's a family that we call crucifers. This is cauliflower, cabbage, broccoli, things like that, right? Now, these require cold water in order to form, cold weather in order to form a head, okay? These wouldn't grow in summer and very unlikely to grow in the monsoons too, especially in a place like Goa. In a place like Bangalore, where you have, now I know warmer summers, but still more moderate weather, you could extend the season. Like you could have cabbages all the way up till March perhaps. Whereas in Goa, after February, you're very unlikely to have that. Now, the second family of things that only grow in winter are the root vegetables. So if anything is growing under the ground, it more or less requires cold weather to grow sweeter, and it requires cold weather to grow larger, right? So you may grow in a coastal place, like, you know, you may go outside Chennai and say that I want to grow carrots. You're going to have very small carrots unless the weather gets unusually cold. Whereas if you're in a cooler place, say Coorg or, you know, someplace Munnar and so on, you would see that you get a lot more carrots over there. So This is the second category of thing that grows best in that weather. So if you consider the winter, the reason I mentioned it first is more or less the widest category of edible food that we are used to eating grows actually in winter. So every other category of food, except you may have sometimes trouble with ladyfinger, sometimes tends to grow well in the winter season. When you can come to summer, all the crucifers, they go away. All the root vegetables go away, and you need semi-shade even to grow many leafy vegetables. So especially if they are from the mustard family. So just to give you an example of leafy vegetables, which are from the mustard family, it may be something like pak choy, you know, that's an Asian green. It may be something like mustard greens, which, you know, we eat in different types in different parts of the year. You of course won't be able to grow things like lettuce. Lettuce especially likes only cool climates and therefore is best grown in when the temperatures are sort of somewhere near 20 degrees or so. You will also find that other leafy vegetables that tend to get aphids as it gets warmer. So this is the mustard family of leafy vegetables. So those should be grown if they are to a smaller extent, and they should be grown in semi-shaded environments. In the monsoon, one of the things that is most difficult to grow, you can also grow tomatoes. All fruiting vegetables do well in the summer. So the gourds, the tomatoes, and even the beans, they tend to do very well in these, in the summer season. In the monsoon season, your challenge will be to grow if you have a if you are in a place with heavy rains, like the coast of India typically sort of experiences. Then a lot of the leafy vegetables get pounded too much, and the leaves, you know, get damaged. So it's not a lot of fun to grow them. But in theory, you know, if you're in a balcony, they can be grown. That's not a problem. Right. One thing that really becomes difficult to grow, or rather a couple of things that get really become difficult to grow in the monsoon are, number one, tomatoes, extremely difficult. I mean, you're just almost 80% likely to fail because it'll catch some kind of fungal disease, which tomato in particular is more susceptible to. You will also struggle to grow things like certain Mediterranean herbs, you know, rosemary, thyme, so on and so forth. They don't like too much humidity either and don't like too much water either. So that's just a snapshot. What we can do is that we will share with you, you know, in a follow-up mail, maybe tomorrow or day after, you know, a few sort of seasonal planting charts, which make it easier to figure out what can grow when.
But the charts are relevant to the coastal.
Yes, yes, but we can adapt them.
Okay, next question. How do you know when root vegetables like ginger and turmeric are ready for harvest?
Okay, so ginger is also turmeric. They are usually 6 month crops. Turmeric also can be longer, a year or so. But to check for any of these, you will probably plant them either in a pot, and you could start by, you know, filling a pot like this with soil all the way there, and you take a few of the fingers of ginger, just put maybe two or three in, the plant will grow. It'll take a minimum of 6 months. So the plant will grow, it'll produce a lot of leaves. And towards the end of those 6 months, you'll find that the leaves are automatically wilting. So that sort of is the point where the rhizomes have multiplied, they've gone to like the size they will, and the plant above the ground will wilt. You can remove the roots, you can harvest, take what you want and leave a few back, refresh the soil, put a few more back, and then that can be your next crop. So to know when it's ready, again, with most root vegetables, just dig your finger inside, move a bit of the soil, and you'll see that, oh, that's a really big root, or that's a small one. So that's the way to check. But by and large, 6 months is the minimum, as with garlic also.
Varun asks about the problem of having folded leaves in lemon plants and a white powdery substance on the leaves. How do you get rid of it?
Can you just say that again, please?
A white powdery substance on the leaves and folded leaves on lemon plants. How do you get rid of them?
Okay.
Again, looks fungal.
Yeah, it looks like it's fungal. If it's really dense, the lemon plant, the first thing would be to prune it off, create good air circulation. That would help. Don't water the leaves constantly. I think that's another thing people often end up doing, is when they're watering a plant, they'll drench it from head to toe. Someone put it really well once. They said, when you're thirsty, you don't jump into a swimming pool to drink. You just have a glass of water. So just give the soil the water, you know, drench the soil well, but don't keep wetting the entire plant. You will just cause more fungal problems. India is a humid country in general. So, you know, try not to soak the whole plant all the time. Leaf curling could be, there are different insects that just, you know, roll leaves and they lay their eggs inside. If it's not a very big plant, find those leaves, pluck it and just get rid of it, so that you're probably getting rid of their home and hopefully the babies that will come thereafter. But again, fungal problems means check humidity levels, make sure it's sunny enough, there's good ventilation, air circulation, even within the plant, not just outside. So if it's too dense, prune it and create more air going through. That should help.
Okay. Here's a question from Ambika Bhani. I live in a society where I have access to a small patch in the common area garden. It has a small slope. I have planted a row of brinjal saplings at the top, a row of chilies, and a row of tomatoes at the bottom of the slope. Is this arrangement okay? Where should I place potatoes next?
Okay, so I would probably put the tomatoes at the top because they require the least amount of water. I would also put the potatoes further up because in general, root vegetables don't like to have a lot of water either. See, if you're growing on a slope, most of your water and moisture is going to slide down to the bottom. And that's really what you're trying to design for, right? So I would say if I was to grow them, these two would be at the top and the chilies would come further down from there. The brinjals, which don't mind a lot. Chilies and brinjals, actually, they handle quite a bit of water without getting into problems. They thrive in the monsoons, for example, in a coastal place also, and therefore they should be completely fine in that situation. You have to make sure, however, that, I mean, just going off each of those different crops requires good amounts of sunlight. And therefore, you need to make sure that it's not as if that the lower part of the slope is very shaded and so on and so forth.
After the cucumber plant starts flowering, what are the tips to help it fruit?
I see, in most situations, you really don't have to do anything further.
Yeah.
Right. Simply because if you've reached the point of flowering, it is going to proceed into fruiting thereafter. One of the things that can happen is that you have falling of flowers happening at that point in time. Right. So you have flowers form and, you know, they fall and therefore you don't end up having fruit. And usually, flowers that are falling means a lack of potash. Right. So you have to make sure that your soil is rich in potash. I think Yogita gave an example other than even magnesium. I think even banana leaves would help a lot in terms of bringing that to your soil. And that's a good additive to put in over there. In addition to this, I would say that you can have a second kind of problem at this point, which is that in cucumber, what you typically see first, what is more apparent is the male flower. But the male flower is not going to turn into a fruit, right? You will see certain other flowers which kind of have a bump behind them. So you have the flower and just behind, you know, where the stem kind of forms, there is a little bit of a bump that forms. And that is the female flower which is going to become the fruit, right? So you want to make sure that you maybe if they are touching the ground and if water is, you know, kind of following on them, you want to make sure that they are kind of raised off the ground a little bit and so that the fruits grow on to stay. But by and large, you shouldn't have problems unless your soil is acidic or something like that, and you end up with only male flowers and not a lot of female flowers.
Okay. Next question from Kora Bhatia. How do you grow watermelons on a terrace garden?
Mm-hmm. Yogi, you want to take that?
Watermelon, melon, pumpkins, ash gourd, these are from the gourd family. They are huge ramblers and they require a lot of place to move, like to run, to just grow. What you could do is if you can create, like if you have maybe two pots, large pots, if you have, I don't know, say like an 18 inch or a 20 inch pot, you can keep them maybe 10 feet apart and you use bamboo to create a trellis so that you connect the two pots. Like if you have two pots like this, the same size, you'll put maybe two sticks here, you'll put two sticks here, and you'll create a frame like a trellis. And you let the plant sort of twine on that so it's above the ground. When the fruit comes, it's a really heavy fruit, you get these net bags that, you know, when you buy a basketball, you often get the basketball in that net bag. So when a fruit is formed, you sort of put it into the net bag and you tie the net bag to the scaffolding that you've created so that the weight is distributed. Normally, these plants are really strong. You can have like a 7-8 kilo ash gourd hanging from a vine and the vine does not break. But this is just to give it additional support. You can, you know, sort of put it into the basket, tie it up and it'll help the fruit stay on. So you have to just, you know, innovatively think of different kinds of trellises that you can utilize on your terrace to give it space to run. And you can grow watermelon on the terrace. I know my uncle in Bombay, he grows them in pots. He lets the vines just ramble. And when the fruit is formed, he puts it in the pot that's closest to it. So he's, I think, just, he couldn't be bothered to make the trellises and all that. He just lets the vine go wherever it's going. And when the fruit is there, he'll just, like, if that's a pot, he'll just lift the fruit and put it there. And then it's growing in some other, it could be like a lemon plant or whatever, but the fruit is sitting in that pot and it's growing and that's also fine. So just think creatively, it's possible to do.
And just to add to that, I mean, in case you don't have a terrace, but you have, say, a balcony, you know, a lot of balconies, especially in cities, end up having those, I don't know whether to say lovely or ugly box grills, you know, those metal grills that are made for safety. So quite often what you can do is you can get the plant to actually grow on those because you don't have a lot of space for them to ramble. So you let them climb up and they'll be fine. You use the same bags like Yogita was suggesting, the net bags, in order to hold the fruit so that it doesn't fall or get damaged.
Okay. We have a question from Varun. I'm just going to allow him to talk on chair.
Sure. Hi, Varun. Varun, are you able to hear me? Could you check if your mic's on?
I guess he's muted and we're not able to unmute him for some reason.
Okay.
We can move to that next or later.
Okay.
There's a question from Ketan. He asks, if sunlight is available from a transparent roof sheet, is it enough to grow?
Oh, yes. Transparent roof sheets are actually wonderful, especially if you're sort of staying in a place where there is a lot of rain. Now, for a place, example, Goa, where, you know, we get about 3 meters of rain every year. If we didn't have transparent roof sheets, we wouldn't be able to raise our nurseries. Our nurseries, for example, have a transparent roof, and that provides protection from the rain and also sufficient light for things to grow well. So yes, it can work well. If you are really finding that things are very warm and sunny, you may want to cover that transparent roof sheet with a little bit of that green shade net, which most of us would have seen, right? It's used on farms in order to eliminate, at least sometimes it's 50% of the sunlight. It could be a higher grade also, but that's typically in the summer. Rest of the year, it's perfect for growing.
Okay. We have a question from Devaki. She asks, how do you get rid of red beaver ants in the garden, specifically like on guava trees?
Okay.
So you basically need to find their nest, and they keep making these nests again and again. You'll find that these red beaver ants, they'll take leaves and they'll sort of glue them together and they'll have their nests inside. And if it's a really tall tree and you can't get to them, then that may be a problem. But if the tree is shorter, the only way to do it is to cut the nest off and discard it. Another way, sometimes what people do is they either hang like an animal's bone from the tree, and the ants tend to get attracted to it. And then they sort of cut the bone, drop it to the ground, and they set the thing on fire with... it's fairly violent and a drastic way to do it. But if you've ever climbed a tree trying to get mangoes, and these are big trees, and you've been attacked by the red fire ants, you could get angry enough to want to do that to them. But the best way is just, you know, find where their nest is, because anything you spray, it'll deter them for a little while. They will disperse, and whether it's cow urine or whether it is a chili, garlic, ginger spray, or whatever it is that you use, it will distract them or disturb their path for a little while, but they will come back. So you have to get to their nest and remove the nest from where it is. That's the way we found that works.
So you will see, I mean, just to add to what Yogita said, again, and coming back to that principle of prevention being better than cure, how we handle a lot of pests is that we try to basically make them uncomfortable in our garden. I'm not sure whether ideally is the right word. You want them to go to your neighbor's garden so that you don't have to deal with them, right? So essentially, if you discomfort them by either moving their nest or creating an unpleasant set of circumstances that they don't like, these pests will kind of move away. And that's exactly what you want.
Okay. She has another question regarding planting different vegetables in a single pot. Could you suggest some combinations that can work?
Okay. So this is a controversial topic. I think everybody I mean, if they just did a simple Google search, they would find 100 different sort of companion planting combinations that people promote, right? We haven't found that we are particularly hard and fast about these things. We worry more about, you know, how we can put together things that work in complementary ways when related to, I mean, in the way that they use light. So just to take an example, we wouldn't grow two types of root vegetables together. If we are growing a root vegetable, then we would, you know, have rows between the root vegetable. I mean, for example, if you had a row of radish, then you may want to have a row in between that is a taller plant, because the radish gets very, you know, very, it has very thick foliage once it grows out, right? So in that way, the radish, which is a fast grower, gets all the sunlight it needs. And this taller plant, taken just to take an example, perhaps brinjal, can get the sunlight it needs because it's towering over the radish and so on and so forth. So I don't think that there are any clear, formulae that we would use in order to say always plant this with this. But for example, other combinations that work are, you can have basil and tomatoes. Now the strong smell of the basil tends to make sure that less insects, tends to cause less interest insects to come around for the tomatoes also, right? There are other examples that you can do, cabbage, for example, with spinach, and that would work pretty well also. So I won't say that we have very hard and fast kind of suggestions about what you put with what. I think that you just try to make sure that you don't put too many of the same family together. So it is, I mean, radish, for example, is a mustard. So I would not be very eager to put radish along with mustard greens, just to take an example.
Just to add to that, one of the things you should consider is that put plants that have similar water requirements together. So what I mean by that is that if leafy vegetables like a lot of water, then don't put them particularly together with tomatoes that don't like too much water. They are okay with having a little less water. Or I once planted lettuce and onions together. And after 4 months when I harvested the onions, the right way to harvest onions once they are done is you just stop watering and you let the leaves dry up completely on top. And what that does is it, you know, sends all the juices down into the bulb. And so you have really nice juicy bulb. But if you harvest while it's still, being watered and the leaves are fresh, then that juice does not sort of go back into the bulb itself. So if I had planted lettuce together with onions and they did fine as long as, you know, it was getting water. But then when the time came to harvest the onions, I could not stop watering the bed because there were still lettuces there. So that sort of, that kind of planning, if you have, then I think many combinations of things will work. So similar water requirements, and if it's a pot, then similar sunlight requirements, so that if something needs a little less sunlight, you can move all of them in the shade and, you know, one of them won't suffer on account of that movement. So I suppose those two things should be considered.
Okay, here's a question from Amita. We planted zucchini. It's flowering, but it has leaf mine.
Minor.
What do we do?
So it depends on the extent of the problem. So what typically happens is we've noticed that in cities, we have higher incidences of leaf miner simply because there are not many places that this insect has to go and lay its eggs. So let me explain what the leaf miner does. Basically, when the leaf is young, an egg has been laid by the insect in the leaf, and then when it's born, the larva kind of comes out and it moves laterally to find the edge of the leaf and exit. Right. So wherever it goes, burrowing through, looking for the edge of the leaf, that's where you see this white line. That happens. Now, if it is very light, like it's only bothering about 10% of the leaves, I really wouldn't worry about it. But if it's gotten to the extent where it's more than that, like it's 25-30% of the leaves, then one of the things that you can do is that you can, in order to prevent that, what you can do is to sprinkle wood ash on the leaves, Okay, so wood ash is basically, if you've seen the woody stems of bushes, you gather a few of these woody stems, little sticks and so on, you burn them and that ash can be sprinkled on the leaves itself. What this does is it makes it unpleasant for the, insect that is the parent insect, and therefore it will not, you know, sort of lay its eggs in such an environment, right? Now, if you already have that, the best thing to do is to actually cut off the badly affected leaves before the damage goes too far, and just, you know, go and drop it into the compost pile or something like that, so that it's far away from the garden.
Okay, I'll just add one more thing to it. Like a 5% neem spray would also help in water. Neem doesn't obviously dilute. Neem oil will not be diluted in water, will not mix in water. So either add a little bit of soap or a teaspoon of alcohol. It will then dissolve. So one teaspoon or 5 ml in 1 liter of water with a little bit of soap or alcohol, and you can spray that. Also cut, like he said, cut and remove and throw the leaves.
The worst infected ones.
The worst infected ones. And one of the main things to remember, like, we could endlessly answer questions about what happens if we have this and what happens if we have that and how do you deal with that pest and that disease. The bottom line is that you have to have great soil. If you have great healthy soil, you will have great healthy plants that will be resilient, that will have the ability to fight attacks from pests and from different kinds of diseases that may come its way. So what a lot of the things we are telling you is like, acha ye hua to do this, wo hua to do this. And that's okay in the short term, but in the long term as a gardener, your main job is just to look after and to build and to maintain great soil. You're like the custodian of great soil. That's all. If you do that, you have done 75% of your job. So you have healthy, in order to have healthy plants, focus on building and maintaining good soil. That is really your primary job as a gardener.
Okay, here's a question from Kumar. He says he has a mint plant which has fungus growing on the soil. He wants to know if it's overwatered or he also asks if it's better to water the plant in the night.
Okay, so there's fungus.
Yogita, it's Yogita's favorite plant.
Yeah, yeah.
It is the reason she started gardening in the first place.
Absolutely.
So I think I'll let her answer this one.
No, so fungus on the soil may not always be bad. I don't know what it looks like. Is the plant looking unhealthy or is the plant still healthy? So if the plant is healthy and there's fungus on the soil, we want to have good fungus in the soil. So I don't know what kind of fungus it is. But if your plant is looking healthy, don't do anything about it. Just make sure you're not overwatering. If you mean if there is the green algae kind of stuff on the soil, then that means you are overwatering, or the drainage from your container isn't good enough. So the water is not coming out. And so with, you know, clay soil, it's holding water too long and you are watering too frequently. So there's this green algae thing that's forming. So that is a problem. About whether you should water at night, it is a good idea to water after the sun is gone, simply because once you water, that water stays in the soil much longer. Like if you water in the evening at around 6 or so, you'll have the water stay in the soil all the way till about 10, 11 o'clock when the sun really picks up and starts evaporating. But if you water in the morning, say at 6 o'clock in the morning or 7 o'clock in the morning, by the time the sun is up in 4 hours, your soil will already start drying. So if you water in the evening, you'll find that water stays longer and is available for plant processes for a longer period of time. So yeah, it's a good idea to water in the evenings.
Next question is from Sarita. Are there any leafy vegetables like spinach or amaranth that can be grown in summer?
Both can be grown in summer. So, yeah. I mean, if you just see, I mean, in the image behind Yogita, for example, she's got spinach on the left and she's got amaranth on the right. And these pots have been, you know, out in the open at this time of the year, right? Both growing fairly well. I would suggest, however, if possible, try and ensure that you, you know, kind of have a little bit of a semi-shaded section as it gets. So, you know, dappled shade from a trees could perhaps be the best place to put it, or at least a space where for a certain time there is good light, but not direct sunlight. Don't grow it in a dark corner, but in a semi-shaded corner.
Where you don't get the hottest part of the sun, like maybe between 12 and 4 or 12 and 3. That's really the warmest time of the day.
There's a lot of questions coming from gardeners in Mumbai asking if the uncertain weather in Mumbai actually creates a problem for growing plants there, and what are the best plants to grow there?
So uncertain weather, I think this year has been a little strange ever since before the monsoon on this coast, on the west coast. The monsoon was a little early in coming and a little late going. The cool weather came only in January, perhaps after the 10th of Jan. And surprisingly, I think it's still cool in the mornings in Goa, and therefore I'm sure in Bombay also. So I would say that this has been a strange year and it can be a little confusing. But for the most part, I think what needs to be grown in different seasons is pretty much similar, whether you are there in Bombay or in any other coastal city on the west coast, even to some extent on the east coast, right? Because you have similar conditions of humidity and heat to deal with. So no particularly different things that we would suggest to grow. As Yogita said, at this time of the year, gourds will do well. This is in the summer and heading into the monsoon. Brinjals will do well, chilies will do well, ladyfinger will do well, beans will do well. These are the families from which I would choose. In terms of the leafy greens, the greens which have a little bit thicker leaves tend to do a little bit better, whereas the ones that have extremely thin leaves don't enjoy it as much.
Okay, we have a question from Sneha Shah. I'm going to allow her to ask questions.
Sure.
Yeah. Sneha. Hi, Sneha. Can you hear us?
Sorry, that wasn't very clear.
I think her audio is not working. Maybe we'll come back to her later.
Okay. Yeah, I think we'll do that.
I think she had the question about the berries and the guava.
Yeah, I think so.
Why they were not producing well. See, fruiting trees produce when they are fed well and they are able to store food to make flowers, to make fruit. So one of the things is that you need to make sure that you are...
Yes. My question was, my blueberry plants are not fruiting. The one which was in pot, it is fruiting. Yeah.
What I understood of your question is that the trees in the pots are fruiting and the ones in the ground aren't. If that's your question, it could be many reasons, but just, check and see if you are fertilizing them equally. Sometimes we just take it for granted that jameen mein it'll figure out its khana peena. It's not like that. They need to be fed as well. And guavas particularly, actually, they can be fruiting pretty much throughout the year. With each, at least three times a year, you can get a crop with guava and with chikus. So just, make sure that your soil is well fed. That's what I can figure out from your problem.
And sunlight.
And sunlight, sufficient sunlight, yes.
Here's the next question from Devaki. My amaranth plant is growing very tall, though I get good large leaves. It's potted in a potting tray, but I see your amaranth plant is nice and bushy. How do I get such bushy amaranth harvest?
So actually, that is many plants in that one pot. And I usually like the amaranth tender, so I tend to cluster and plant them together. I keep snipping the plants, harvesting them, and then they grow back. But I think one of the ways, which we also sometimes do, is literally put like one plant in a 10-inch size pot like this. It will grow nice and big. And the thing is, every time you harvest, every time you cut it, it forces the plant to branch. And that's true for many leafy vegetables, also true for herbs like basil. So I don't know how frequently you're harvesting it, but if you don't frequently harvest, it'll grow tall and you'll just have one main stem. But if you cut it at the top, then it'll branch from there. And then each time you snip the other plant the other side branches, it'll, you know, grow bushy from there. And that's one way to sort of get it to be really nice and bushy. But in there, there must be, I don't know, at least about 35, 40 plants. But I like the leaves nice and tender. So that's why I just plant it very densely.
So as Yogita said, it depends how you like to eat amaranth. And that's different for different people. Some of them who like to cook it like are okay with a little older leaves. And some who want to have the leaves virtually raw or very lightly cooked may want younger leaves like Yogita has kind of grown over here.
Okay. So the next question is from Avatano. What soil can be used in a nursery that is for sprouting seeds? And is sprouting in eggshells a good idea?
Okay, so in terms of nurseries, first is what you would do if in ideal circumstances. But if you see many of the things we mentioned during the early part of this session, you know, we've talked about these because we are in an unusual set of circumstances. In an ideal world, how we raise seedlings in our nursery is we use a mix of about 50% vermicompost and 50% cocoa soil. Cocoa soil or cocoa peat is something which is, it's like the dust from coconut husk, right? And it's great because it's fairly sterile, number one. So you don't need to use any mud or dirt in order to, have your medium. It's rich in organic matter. So it actually soaks up moisture and holds it there and keeps it available for the young seedlings, right? It's like a child having 6 feeds in a day, something like that, you know? So easy availability of water whenever the little plant needs it. The second part of it, which is where the nutrients come from, is vermicompost. Again, we use vermicompost and not cow dung or compost because since it's basically been digested by the enzymes of earthworms, you end up with no issues related to seeds left over or pathogens and other things like that. And these, you know, make it easier to grow also. I think you could also, I mean, if you're short of compost at this point in time, you might try 70% cocoa soil and 30% compost, vermicompost, and that would be all okay also, right? However, given the circumstances we have now, I would say that, you know, you pretty much use whatever you have. So if you can take up a lot of, soil, scrape up some soil, and this is the beautiful part about doing nurseries. You don't need to have a lot of soil to start a nursery. So if you went and scraped up some soil from the neighborhood, from the garden, and you mixed in, you know, a little bit of nutrients in it, you can go a pretty long way. You'll have good seedlings, no problems. And then maybe when inputs are available, you can shift to using cocoa soil and compost.
So I'll just reiterate that it is okay to start with whatever you have right now. You have another 2 to 3 weeks to transplant these plants. So you have time to figure out your soil, to improve whatever soil you've got, to maybe, if things open up, to lay your hands on compost, or you can start composting at home and you can get compost in. It takes at least about, I would say, 2 to 3 months. But whatever, you do have time to get your soil started. And we'll talk about ways in which we can do that in the next session. But, you know, just start your seedlings. Don't worry about what am I going to do for soil and I need so much of it. You have 2-3 weeks to plan for that. So do get going.
Okay. I think this is the question that Varun wanted to ask. He's asked it like about 2-3 times. He has a patch of land which has no direct sunlight. He asks if he can start growing vegetables and what kind of vegetables can he grow there.
So there are limitations to what you can grow in shady places. There are a set of shade tolerant plants, but most vegetables, again, I'm not sure how dense his shade is. You know, if it's very dense shade, then vegetables are very unlikely. But there are other things that are food that you can grow. For example, from an earlier question, if you were growing ginger or you were growing haldi, those are things that you can grow in the shade.
Black pepper.
Oh yeah, black pepper is another example. Tapioca. Pineapples, tapioca, yam or suran, you know. So colocasia, these are different things that you can grow in the shade itself and they will be fine. I think what you may end up having to do is just look for places where there are little pockets of light even amongst a shaded space. And that's where you will be able to try leafy vegetables. They are more likely to do fine even when the light levels are a little lower. But fruiting vegetables and fruit trees, they require, you know, a lot of sunlight, at least 4 hours of sunlight, 5 hours of sunlight in order to be productive. So tomatoes and all wouldn't really work there. Brinjals, chilies and so on, not so well.
Yeah. Amita asks what Panchagavya is and if it's a manure of some kind.
Yeah, so Panchagavya is actually made from, it's a microbial concoction that is made by fermenting together five products that you get from the cow. So they put in milk, they put in dahi, they put in ghee, they put in cow dung and cow urine. And to supercharge that, they will put in jaggery and a little bit of besan and, you know, overripe bananas and, you know, just food for the microbes. And they put in, they inoculate it with a handful of soil from a nice dark corner of your garden or anyone's garden that's got probably a lot of microbes in it. And they let it ferment for about 3 weeks. And in that period, the microbes just multiply and you'll have the microbes. Amongst others, there is lactobacillus, which is found in milk. And these are actually very good for your soil. So it becomes a liquid fertilizer. You don't use it directly once it's made. And the recipes are available very easily online. You just do a search for Panchagavya. You'll get all the proportions and how to make it. You dilute it in a 30% solution. And you can, oh, sorry, a 3% solution. And you spray it on your plants. You can use it as a foliar spray. Or you can water the soil, the roots with it. And if you do it for a lot of these annual plants once in every 15 days or even once a month, it adds a good dose of, it adds a kick to your soil. It gives the plants some tonic that they need as they grow.
I'd like to add that, you know, the recipe is easy to find, but finding the cow dung and cow urine in most cities may take a bit of work.
We just have a couple more questions to go. Kora asks, how long do lady fingers and brinjals take to harvest?
Okay, so first depends on the season. So lady finger probably grows fastest in the summer. You know, it loves the heat and you can have them in as little as two months. Yeah. I think sometimes even 6 to 8 weeks you have lady finger happening. Brinjals, a little more than 2 months. I would say at least 2 months, going closer to 2.5, 3, right? 2.5 months is what I would say would be the average time for brinjals. They handle the heat fine. They handle the monsoon fine and they're okay. Since our cold is not very, you know, very harsh, they're okay in cool weather also.
Just to add to that, it's a bit of a tricky thing when to harvest the bhindi. And I've gotten it wrong a lot in the beginning. But, you know, you see the bhindi, it'll be that small and then it'll be that small. And then suddenly you say that, oh, this has become too fibrous and I can't harvest. Or I can harvest it, but it'll not be fun to eat. So it'll take a little bit of getting to know it. The typical test, even when we go to buy bhindi, is that when you snap the tip, it breaks with a nice crisp sound rather than if it just, like, you know, falls over and it doesn't break away, then it is overripe. It becomes fibrous and you can't eat it. And similarly with brinjal, they're going and you don't know. And suddenly they're just too seedy inside and you can't eat them. So with brinjals, you know, just see as they are growing, the point where you find that they are growing no more in size, and don't let that period last too long. Like the minute you see, acha bada ho raha hai, now it's sort of stabilized. Also know the variety you're growing. Some are long, some are small and round, some are large, the bharta type. So know the variety that you're growing. And then you will have a sense ki, haan, ye toh abhi theek hai, I can take it out. And with bhindi, you will get the first few wrong. Either it'll be too early and you'll say, oh, if I'd waited, it could have become this much longer and that would have been better. Or it would be too late. So get a few of them wrong and you'll figure out, ha, this is the time when I need to optimally harvest it.
The other one that's tricky is corn. The first few times you always end up doing the corn in a way where the kind of pieces haven't formed yet. So that's one common one to get wrong.
We have a question on composting at home. Given the current constraints, What is the best way to compost at home, and will it smell or should it be kept on the terrace?
So composting smells only when it goes wrong, and there's a chance that you will get it wrong until you get the hang of it. In the initial bits, you know, people tend to make mistakes. Given the current circumstances, you could try something like 3 paint buckets, example, and you could use those to compost. It may be the easiest thing to sort of find at this point in time. A couple of principles that, you know, you need to keep in mind for most basic home composting. First of all, a lot of people ask us whether they need to have worms compost, and you don't really need worms. I don't think you want to take the effort to raise worms in order to do your composting. Just simple, you know, aerobic decomposition is good enough. What you have to watch out for is basically two things. Number one, is there the right amount of water in your compost pile? So typically your vegetables, as they decompose, they release a lot of water, and that means that the compost pile gets too wet. This eliminates the air from the compost pile, and that's what creates the smell. It's also what creates the perfect environment for maggots to breed. So people will see worms coming out of their compost and get completely freaked out. So what you need to do is to add in dry matter. It could be, you know, if you can get some dry leaves or sawdust or cocos oil, or in this situation, if I was really hard up, I would even take shredded newspaper, even though that has small amounts of inks in it, and soak up all the excess moisture so that the composting process proceeds properly, and so that you don't have problems of smell and maggots, right? The second thing is to make sure that your pile is turned over regularly. That is, that you are introducing air into the pile. So this is the other thing people will do. They'll keep on piling stuff in, and the bottom parts, you know, are really not getting any air. So you just want to use a couple of sticks, or if you have maybe, you know, like a couple of garden tools, that hand tools, those can be used too. Oh yeah, that fork, yeah, or the bigger one that belongs in the garden. And you can basically, you know, use these to turn the bottom up and so on. Yeah. So if you turn the pile over and make sure there is air introduced, air can be introduced just twice in a week. In terms of the dry matter, it should be put in as you are putting in the waste itself. If you're putting in like a mug full of kitchen waste, then put in a mug full of dry matter to soak up that excess moisture.
I think we're done with questions. But before we end this, I had someone who has been making vegetables in his backyard for the past 6 months reach out to me today. Mm-hmm. So I thought I'll let him talk, share his experiences for 5 minutes, and then you can end. So this is to essentially bring out everyone in the community, essentially share their experiences.
Sure, that would be amazing.
That's Amitesh and his wife. They grow it together. Amitesh, you're on. You can unmute yourself.
Hello.
Hi, we can hear you.
Yeah, hi. Myself, Tanishka.
Hi.
And it was like a very, very good presentation here, and it's like so, I feel so happy to listen to so many people who have been like growing veggies, and for us it has been a very new experience actually. So we shifted to this place, and we have a huge backyard. It's like 2,000 square feet of the space that we have. Am I audible?
Yes.
Yeah. So we have like this huge space, and we started experimenting with like growing veggies. And just to like give a little background. So I'm just like you guys, or all of you guys, I was like completely novice before these 6 months, and I've never like except from my school projects where I grew like the rajma plant for the science project, I had never grown anything by myself. So it was very new experience. But my parents had visited me here, and we started growing. We started like very small. We start with the coriander seeds, and then later on we sown some like the winter veggies, spinach, methi, and soya. Then we took the next step. We grew garlic, so it's like almost ready for the harvest. If I can like switch on my video, then I could have shown you guys the garden. I've given you guys the garden tour, but I guess if it's possible, then we can do that. the video?
I don't know, the tech guy.
I don't think we can do that now, but in one of the next sessions, we'll certainly try to arrange it.
Okay, yeah. So that's a little story. And when I started doing that, then we gained like a lot of confidence that we can take this little further. Then we started growing a lot of tomatoes. And now the garden is full of tomatoes, brinjal. We have already sown the summer veggies, which is like all the guard family, cucumber, kakdi, and bhindi. We also have like a huge tangerine tree, and we have started growing fruits as well. So lychee, pomegranate, santra. We stay in Noida.
Okay.
It's like in the center of study, but we are privileged or lucky that way because we got the space. And I think we'll consider ourselves lucky that in the center of the city, we have got this huge space to grow all these veggies. So that's truly a blessing, actually.
And also, your parents are the best kind of bad influence, I can see, since they've got you started on this.
No, that's a good influence, actually. So my father, he has a farming background. I have like farming roots, but I was never into farming myself. So he has a lot of experience, and he loves doing that. He even now also he does that, even when he's retired. He kind of keeps on doing it entire day. So his schedule is like he'll get up in the morning, and for next 4-5 hours he'll be on the farm doing things by himself. And then he's all tired and rest for the entire of the day. So he started me with this, and he's like a mentor to me whenever I face any problem. So I just call him up and ask him that this is the problem I'm having. And he also tells me that you should water this plant this much, or this is the time that you should grow this kind of veggie. So I think two of my very helpful resources, my father, and then next is YouTube, obviously. And also with the composting, so I was hearing a lot of things that you guys were saying. So we have actually anything that comes out of our kitchen goes into our garden. Every last bit of thing, it goes into our garden. This is the practice that we have actually, we have been practicing this from last 6 months. And you feel really good about it at the end, because you are actually decreasing the waste, as well as it's going into something very good. So we don't need to get the compost and fertilizers from outside, because we are creating it ourselves. And initially we started with the pit. So we had this pit in the backyard, and the problem with it was that we had to turn it over regularly. So now I was following this YouTube channel, Self-Sufficient Me. So he's a great guy. He's from Australia. And he shared this tip in one of his YouTube videos. So he said that just dig a hole anywhere in the garden where you are growing something, or where you are preparing the bed, and throw in your kitchen waste there, and just dump the soil over that. And you don't have to worry about turning it over. And you are just creating the bed in itself. It's a very, very good tip that he gave. And we have been following that. And you won't believe it that like few days back, I did the same thing. And I am seeing some of these sprouts there. Maybe by mistake, I threw some fruit seeds. I think it must be watermelon or something. And they have sprouted.
Wonderful.
Sounds amazing.
It sounds really amazing. You've got a good thing going, I think, for the next 6 months. Actually, for the last 6 months. And I think it's caught you, and it's going to pull you by the nose, and you're going to be going in this direction for a while, I think.
Yeah, and also like now I've been very enthusiastic about it. So initially it just started as a side project or hobby sort of thing. But I think it grows on you with time. It's quite addictive.
Yeah.
when you harvest something of your own, and then when you cook it, it's an altogether very different experience. Absolutely. Not just with the taste, but also it's a very humbling experience in the way that you know that a lot of effort goes into it, and you really cherish that.
Absolutely.
Somebody once said, after all the hard work, the food tastes better automatically.
Yeah. But obviously, there's a lot of difference in the veggies that we buy from the market, because obviously, they reach us after like 9 to 10 days of harvesting. And this is just fresh from the ground. You pluck it and you just cook it. So obviously, the taste is good. But then again, as you said, the hard work.
In terms of the food, right? Like, so I lived at this institute called the Sambhavna Institute in Himachal. It's near Palampur. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So I've stayed there for a week or so. Mm-hmm. So it's entirely organic. Okay. They grow their own food. They have their own eggs. Yes. You have compost. It's a hilly slope. So you have different veggies on the slopes. And the fresh food. So you cook. It's a community kitchen. You cook there yourself. I really want to make my garden now, now that I hear you. On that note, I will interject and I will ask Karan and Yogita to finish if they want to. And we can continue at friends.hasgeek.com, which will redirect you to our Slack channel. Yogita and Karan will be there. I'll try to bring Tanishka and Amitesh as well, so that there is an active set of people who's there available to answer your queries. And I hope to see a lot of pics with lots of images.
Yep. Thanks.
I think it makes sense for us to do this on Slack, because I'm worried about our phones blowing up, which they seem to have been doing for the last week or 10 days since this lockdown sort of started. Thanks so much for all the help doing this. I hope all of you found it useful, and I hope you will join us again next week on Thursday when we go ahead with this. And if you want more help, you can get in touch. We have my number up over there. Just WhatsApp me and I'll try and help as much as we can.
Yeah, great.
Thanks so much, everybody. Thanks for making this happen. All the best to you. And please take care of yourselves. Be well.
And be occupied. Yeah. Great. Thanks, everyone.